Thank you very much, Miles and Lisa. It is indeed a pleasure to be here, and we are very happy to be here and also to present our collaborative work that we have been doing over the past maybe 2 years. It was a chance meeting with Miles when he was in Sri Lanka on one of his visits that we happened to meet, and I just said about this problem, and then after that we started talking more about it, and then things worked out, and finally we were able to get some funding from RTI for this project. So what I would do is I would give you a general picture of the problem, the Sri Lankan health system, and then Kamani will take you through the different studies and the things that have been done trying to identify the cause of this kidney disease problem. So Sri Lanka is famous for its tea plantations also the lovely beaches, and there is also my nice waves for surfing if you are interested. Wildlife, rich culture and heritage. We have, this is an annual pageant that we have in Kandy. So these are some things which we are famous for. Just at a glance, we have a population of approximately 21 million. We have a land area of about 25,000 square miles. Basically, we are about 300 miles by 150 miles, the length and the width of the country. Our health system has performed exceptionally over the years. Our life expectancy at birth is about 55 years for both men and women, and that to achieve better. Very low investment. Literacy rate is over approximately 95% in both males and females. 100% of all of births occur in institutions where there is specialized trained staff. Immunization coverage of the major vaccine preventable diseases is over 98%. We have 8 infectious diseases targeted for elimination, including polio, malaria, filariasis, diphtheria, tetanus, and so on. Healthcare and tertiary education. Healthcare and education up to tertiary level is all provided free of charge by the government. And we are currently experiencing the demographic and epidemiological transition, where NCDs is a major problem. Since the CKDU is chronic kidney disease, unidentified origin. So since the 1990s, the incidence of chronic kidney disease has increased in the North Central Province. And this was seen more in men in their prime, about 30s and 40s, and mainly associated with agricultural work. In these people, we could not find any known risk factors of chronic kidney disease like diabetes, hypertension, or even past kidney disease. So these were coming on Saturday, and then Kamani will talk to you more about it. So men associated with agricultural work the most killed. Now if you look at from 2002 to 2007, these are the different provinces. Here we have the North Central Province, the Northern Province, Central Province, Western Province, Northwestern Province, and so on. We can see the cases per 1,000 persons is gradually rising. This was in the early part of the last decade. Then if you look at, this is data from the Global Burden of Disease. If you look at the top 20 deaths in 1990 and 2001, chronic kidney disease has remained about the same. But as you can see, most of our biggest problem are the non-communicable diseases. But this is playing an important role here. If you look at in terms of DALYs, disability-adjusted life years, chronic kidney disease has moved from 17th position to 14th position in 2010. This is in 2012. The leading causes of hospitalization, this is a rate per 100,000 population, and you can see diseases of the urinary system being within the top 10 leading causes of hospitalization. Likewise, if you look at the leading causes of hospital deaths, these are in government hospitals. In 2012, this is also a rate per 100,000 population. Again, it is there within the first 10, top 10 leading causes. Now, if you look at the deaths, now this again is a chart from the Global Burden of Study, Global Burden of Disease Study. And here in blue, you have the non-communicable diseases. In red and orange, you have the communicable diseases. And in green, you have the injuries and diseases due maternal diseases. The intensity of the color here indicates the greater impact on the number of deaths, the intensity as well as the size of the area. Now, if you look at this, is in 1990, the kidney diseases are comprise this amount of burden. And out of this, this amount is due to chronic kidney disease due to diabetes, and this due to hypertension. So all the rest fall in here, where most of the chronic kidney disease of unidentified origin comes. Now these are for the deaths. Now these are the deaths in 2020. Again, here you see the largest proportion of our chronic kidney disease, we cannot identify a cause. This is in terms of DALYs. Again, you see the largest burden is due to unidentified kidney disease. Same thing here in 2010. And as you can see, the area of this graph that is taken by the blue color is increasing with time. So NCDs being the greater problem. So these are some of the areas in which we have been working and in which the CKDU patients have been identified. So as you can see, they are in the center of the country. This is in the non-central province. These are where some of the patients have been identified. So you can see the hot spots. Keith and I visited this area when it was last there. So approximately 22,000 individuals are affected. And 8,000 CKDU patients are currently treated in this Anuradhapura region. And annually about 2,000 new patients are registered in here. Just a quick look at the impact. Our health budget last year was 150 billion Sri Lanka rupees, which is about 1.2 billion US dollars. Now, each dialysis session costs between 8,000 to 10,000. Which is about 62p. and advanced patients may have to have about 2 to 3 sessions a week. The average monthly income of farmers in the region is about $100. Now, dialysis facilities are available only in the main cities and quite far away from villages, and patients from villages have to spend a lot on transportation costs. It is estimated that around 4 to 5% of the health budget is spent on treatment of CKD patients. So this is the burden of the problem, the societal cost. And if you look at transplantation, you are looking at about $8,000. Right. So these are some of the scenes that are generally seen. You can see pesticide spraying, not much protective clothing. So various theories have come. And then people have investigated things in different ways. So here also some of the signs which have been described, and because of this, a lot of theories have evolved. And now Kamini will take you through the rest of the presentation, where she will explain what has been done and what is known right now. So thank you very much. And I'd like to thank especially these scientists from Duke, as well as Miles and Keith from RTI for facilitating this talk. Thank you very much.
Can I ask you a question before you go on? For the graph you had on showing burden of disease in Sri Lanka, there is a large square with self-harm. Is that all suicides? And it's, do you have
a... I think right now, according to the latest statistics, the third leading. The country with the third highest burden.
Is there a reason for such a high suicide rate?
There are many reasons, and one has been also failure of crops over the years, the drought and things like that. So that has been a major issue. And also good to note is in 1990 this was the contribution of the war, and that is not there in 2010. So that was because the end of the separatist war in 2009, and then the large chunk of our burden was increased. Any other?
Very privileged to be here, and thank you very much for the invitation to share some of the work we have done in Sri Lanka with this mysterious kidney disease to unravel the etiology. So it's a beautiful island in the Indian Ocean, so therefore the name given as a pendant of the Indian Ocean. So the country is divided into 3 ecological zones, the dry zone occupying major part of the country, and the intermediate zone and the wet zone where the Colombo, the main city, is situated. And it's also divided into 9 provinces, mainly for the administrative purposes. Our main interest is here in the North Central Province. So in early 1990s, a new form of kidney disease was recognized in the north central reply zone of Sri Lanka. And this is the region which was the seat of the ancient kingdoms and civilizations. So you can see the ancient ruins in the region. So the disease was first reported in the north central province, and now it is extending into the northwestern and the eastern provinces in the close proximity to the north central province. The disease is not attributed to the known conventional risk factors, so therefore it's known as CKD or unknown etiology or CKDU. The affected area covers approximately 17,000 square kilometers of land. About 2.5 million population is there. It's about 10% of the country's population. The temperatures range from 32 to 34 centigrades with a quite lower rainfall throughout the year. Rice farming is the main occupation. Other interesting thing is that you see a large network of reservoirs built by the ancient kings in the region that provide water to the rice plantations. So the CKDU is not unique to Sri Lanka. You see similar hotspots in the other parts of the world, El Salvador, Nicaragua, and Costa Rica, which is known as the malady of the sugarcane, where the sugarcane workers are affected. And Andhra Pradesh in India, it is also known as the land of widows, and it is the region here is similarly affected. So the definition, so it was necessary to have a definition when you do the research work. So therefore this research definition was developed quite later on, actually 2010. So the definition is absence of past history of known risk factors for kidney disease and absence of diabetes. And when the blood pressure is there, it's not very high blood pressure, which is controlled with less than 140/90. With two antihypertensive medication. This is to exclude the chronic kidney disease secondary to hypertension. So there are several population prevalence studies available. So Atrodia and then they did in 2003-2006, where they got a prevalence of 3.7% to 3.9%. And quite interestingly, they found that in this region, which is called Kuruluvera, in the endemic area, there were no CKD of unknown cases. And our studies, which we used more sensitive microalbumin test to detect urine microalbumin, did show 6.3% of incidence in 2006. The most recent study has given us some startling figures of 15,000 in the region between 15 to 70 years, mainly 30 years of age being affected. So the age standard prevalence. Initially we thought it's a predominantly a disease of the males, but the WHO study has given us some data that in the females at the very early stages the kidney disease was prevalence was higher in the females than the males. However, the severe stages of kidney disease, the stage 3 and 4 of chronic kidney disease, is more frequently seen in the males. Even the hospital-based statistics tells us about the male predominance of the disease. So the disease burden already Raj has given to you. And by putting these hospital patients into the area, MAP has been able us to recognize some areas, these two areas, the Madhavachya and Padavia, as very high density areas, higher endemic areas in the region. So this is the area which most of our studies have concentrated. So it has given a powerful story for the media. First came into public domain in 2002. And since then, it has become a major political and national issue in our country. So what I'm going to present you is the research data that are available from several research groups, local research groups, and the WHO came to Sri Lanka in 2009-2010. That was by far the largest study that has taken place, which they did the population screening, risk factor evaluation, and quite large things with exposure to pesticides and also I will be presenting some data based on these studies. So this is the disease profile. So in the hospitals, we do see a male preponderance, 1:1.3 ratio, and the farmers are being mainly affected. It is a slowly progressive disease. The disease is asymptomatic in early stages, so they do present at quite late stage into the hospitals. Unlike the CKD due to diabetes or hypertension, the edema, high blood pressure are late features. Almost all patients do have a small kidneys ultrasonically with increased echogenicity, and the histology has confirmed that it is a tubulointerstitial disease. Some of these patients, as Raj showed you the pictures, they have some pigmented skin lesions and some hyperkeratosis of the palms, but they are most likely to be occupation related rather than due to arsenic related skin manifestations. So they do not have any other features of chronic arsenic or cadmium toxicity. There was no evidence of urothelial tumors. That's very important, particularly in differentiating from the Balkan endemic nephropathy, because this disease has many similarities to Balkan endemic nephropathy except for the urothelial tumors. And hypertension was identified as the leading determinant of disease progression, and it comes at a later stage. Deaths were occurring mainly at the stage 4 and 5 of the disease. Unlike diabetic chronic kidney disease, cardiovascular deaths are less common in CKD2 patients. So we looking at some of the risk factors. This is one of the very first studies that we have done. I have combined two studies we have done here. So we found, by doing some case control studies, hospital-based and community-based, we recognize some risk factors. Being a farmer, using pesticides, drinking well water at home, and drinking water from the well situated near the in the field, and having a family member with a renal dysfunction and taking local or Ayurvedic treatment in the past were recognized as risk factors for the disease. So based on these observations, we postulated that the regional clustering of the disease, the family history, and the risk factors, so therefore the disease could be due to a possible genetic predisposition to the potential environmental factor. This is one of the conclusions we made with very early studies. And these are some demographic characteristics of the population. So you can see the large number, males, 85% of them were agriculture-based occupations. Quite interesting, even the females, 71% of them even were involved in the agriculture-based activities. The 99% of them were taking the water for drinking and cooking purposes from the well situated in the garden. And this is a source of drinking water. And that this is back in 2004, a lot of people were drinking water from the small wells that were situated in the fields when they go out to field for work. So based on these, having done some literature survey on the global factors, we came into some possible risk factors. We thought plant toxins are possible, and we also thought about geo-environmental factors, whether it's the water is a possible risk factor, pesticide exposure, and extreme weather conditions. So I will go, as I go on, I will give you some of the findings. Because we thought about the herbal medicines, it came as a risk factor in our case control studies. So looking at the world literature, we learned the Chinese herbal nephropathy and Balkan endemic nephropathy and the Aristolochia indica, which produces aristolochic acid, is indigenous to Sri Lanka. And we found that they were used in Ayurvedic pharmacopoeias for many diseases in the past. And the WHO was also quite interested in this. And they looked at several Ayurvedic prescriptions, and they found that about 66 prescriptions contain aristolochic acid available and used for over 20 diseases. However, given the wider use of Ayurvedic treatment in the other parts of the country, this alone may not be responsible for the etiology of CKDU. So we were also interested in fungal toxins, particularly the ochratoxin, which is a mycotoxin produced by the fungi Penicillium and Aspergillus species. They can present as a natural contaminant of variety of plant products. And they, in addition to the mutagenic and oncogenic properties, they also have nephrotoxic properties. So what we did was, we evaluated the aflatoxin concentration in samples of rice and cereals from the endemic areas, and we found that aflatoxin was present in these samples. However, the levels were below the statutory maximum limit recommended by the FAO and the WHO. And there was another study which came afterwards, where they detected the mycotoxin in urine samples in patients with CKDU patients and non-affected relatives. So that toxin is there in the environment. However, and also they found these levels were significantly higher than the Japanese control. So that toxin, potential toxin, is there, but at a lower level. So Dishanayak and them, they did some GPS and GIS mapping of the geographical distribution of the CKDU, and they got some interesting results. In some of these areas, they found these affected villages are located below the reservoirs and canals with stagnant water. So they were just putting up this theory. So whether it is possible that there may be some toxin that is present in the irrigated water and that drains into the shallow wells where the people obtain water for drinking, and could that be the purpose? So they found that blue-green algae, which is which produces cyanobacterial toxin, grows abundantly in these reservoirs, particularly during the dry season. They have some nephrotoxic effects. And in animal studies, they demonstrated these toxins can cause acute tubular necrosis in mice. However, still to link it to the CKDU has not been possible. So another potential toxin that is present in this environment. So then the geoenvironmental factors. Again, we found that these are the endemic foci of this disease in the north central province. Even within an endemic village, certain households are affected. And the source of drinking water is 93% coming from the dug wells. They are deep or shallow wells. And the communities who consumed water from the natural spring did not show CKDU. Quite interesting finding. So there were, is it possible something in this water causing the disease, the etiology for the disease? And again, these areas were, they overlap. The CKDU prevalent regions, you can see, they overlap with the high groundwater fluoride zone in Sri Lanka. This is a source of drinking water. And they either, these are dug wells, either they are deep wells, and a lot of people do use the shallow wells like this. And some studies did show the fluoride was another metal that is high in the region, and there's a lot of dental fluorosis in the region. So the distribution of fluorides in drinking water wells used by the CKDU patients were studied, and you can see the limits. And this is the WHO recommended level, 0.5 milligrams per liter, and it was most of the wells, they have high fluoride levels. So could it be fluoride? However, looking at, again, further study did show there are other areas in the country. This is the CKDU area, I have put it in red, but there are other areas, particularly Hambantota. You can see there's no CKDU. However, the fluoride content is high. In order to explain this, so the researchers looked at other values in water. What they did found was all the endemic areas, there were medium to high level of fluoride. In addition, they found the sodium variation in the sodium and the calcium ratio in the two areas. Where in the endemic areas, it's hard water and the calcium levels were high. And the other area, sodium was the predominant cation in the non-endemic area. So they postulated, they put forward the theory, whether it is the cytotoxicity of fluoride, which is enhanced by the effect of calcium and sodium in the ingested water on the fluoride metabolism. So with the dissemination of this knowledge into the public, so there were a lot of fear among the public to consume the water. So as a result, so there were, you can see some RO units being installed in the in some places, and even the bottled water, people were drinking bottled water, so that has another effect. So the, because they are expensive, people have to spend on that. They will not drink enough water. So that is another consequence of these findings. So then came the agrochemicals, fertilizers and pesticides. So are they related to the CKDU? Then naturally the question comes, there are other areas of the country where there is paddy cultivation, the same fertilizers and pesticides being used. So why only in the north central region? So it's very unlikely that this alone is the etiology of the CKD. So I'm sure you are all aware of 1962 about the silent spring, that the debate came here in USA. So the green revolution in Sri Lanka. So is it green revolution to be blamed? So this is, the aim was to become self-sufficient in rice production. In 1960s, we introduced the agricultural package where we used high yielding varieties, increased use of agrochemical inputs, and increased cropping patterns certainly gave us the effects. We became self-sufficient in rice. And these are the areas that we are talking about are the gives the highest the yield in the paddy cultivation. So so as a result of this, the question came, is it the green revolution is the what is responsible for the CKDU? So in order to look at this, we did some studies. So we used red cell acetylcholine esterase levels as a marker of organophosphate exposure, and we took four groups of patients with CKD from the endemic region who were exposed, people from CKD from non-exposed area, and some controls from Moratuwa fishing village who does not have any exposure to organophosphates. And we found that the red cell acetylcholine levels in exposed CRF patients were significantly lower than unexposed CRF patients. In chronic kidney disease itself, you can get acetylcholine levels could be low, but exposed patients, they are were. So there may be, it's not hard evidence, so this probably gives us some reason to perhaps look further into the effects of pesticides. And in the WHO study, which goes as the National CKDU Research Team study, they did the pesticide residues in urine in CKDU cases. In fact, this is not available to us in Sri Lanka. So you can see, they looked at several pesticides, and these were the reference levels. This is a percentage of CKDU cases above the reference limit. However, they did not look at a control sample here. So you cannot make a lot of interpretation based on that. It is just to say, even with the patients with CKDU, still probably they work with the pesticides and they continue to get exposed. Even if that this is not the etiology, it could have some effect on the progression of the disease perhaps. So the glyphosate issue is there now. There were one article already with the possible hypothesis whether the glyphosate can cause chronic kidney disease. And this is, I believe it is banned in El Salvador, and there was a proposed ban in Sri Lanka, but I must say we do not have any data or any evidence so far to say glyphosate is the cause for the chronic kidney disease. So now coming to the heavy metals linked to CKDU. So we all know about the cadmium, which is in toxic levels can cause kidney disease. We have evidence from Itai disease in Japan. So the half-life of cadmium can be very prolonged, 20 to 30 years. And urinary cadmium excretion is an indicator of chronic exposure. The levels up to 3 micrograms per gram creatinine is thought to be, it's recommended as safe limits. However, this study, enhanced study, observational data has shown that albuminuria can occur, association of albuminuria, even with the lower urinary cadmium levels, about 1 micrograms per gram creatinine. So again, so people started looking at cadmium, and there were a lot of data coming in This is one of the very first studies on cadmium where they again thought with this approach and host of the Green Revolution. In this study, they in fact, to keep it simple, so cultivated soil and the sediments from the reservoirs and cadmium in rice, but this and the lotus rhizomes where the local people sometimes eat the lotus rhizomes, all were found to have high cadmium levels in this very first study. And it was thought the superphosphate, triple superphosphate fertilizer is probably the source of cadmium coming into the soil. And even the National Research Team study did confirm these, some of these results. They also thought, they also demonstrated slightly higher levels of cadmium in the soil in the endemic areas. Vegetables, high cadmium levels. Again, the lotus root, they confirmed, but they were so much lower than the first study. Freshwater fish, very slight, it was 0.06 milligrams per kilogram, slightly above the European standards, but the rice within the allowable limits. And in the National Research Team study, they further demonstrated statistically that there was a dose effect response between the urine cadmium levels and the CKDU. And the cadmium in nails was significantly higher in CKDU patients, but there were no significant difference in the cadmium in hair. So, however, there was some other data by another two groups which does not confirm the above findings. So you can see there was some controversy in the findings of the cadmium levels. This is the, just to summarize the urinary cadmium excretion. This is the first study that I told quite high levels, but there was some doubt as to the analytical methodology in here. And these were the WHO levels, so they were just at the level that the enhanced study said that it can cause some damage to the kidneys. This study perfectly normal. Our another study we can see not very high levels. Coming to the arsenic, so arsenic absorption can occur predominantly from the small intestine, but from the skin contact and inhalation also can get absorbed. Inorganic forms of arsenic are more toxic than organic forms, and the most serious effect of arsenic is on the skin, dermatological changes and also the malignancies of the skin. These are the chronic arsenic poisoning, but in our patients, we have not seen any of these arsenic changes in the CKDU patients. So again, the urinary arsenic excretion, the acceptable levels again becomes different. In Western countries, it is 10 to 15 micrograms per gram creatinine. It's up to this level accepted as normal, but in Japan, it's slightly higher levels. And up to 100 micrograms, can be taken as unexposed by the USA standards. This is the USA average urinary excretion coming from the enhanced study in 2003 and 2004. However, heavy seafood consumption can exceed this limit due to the presence of inorganic arsenic. So the urinary arsenic excretion, these are the two studies for the comparison. Quite interestingly, this is a WHO study. They did not find, they actually found the higher levels of urinary arsenic in the controls, but not in the CKDU patients. However, their conclusion, how correct, I'm not very sure. They said because of this, there may be high arsenic present in the environment, which I do not agree with them. And this is another study which we have done. You can see these levels, there were no significant difference between the levels. So here we took some non-pharma controls from the Western province. You can see more or less the same, the control. There were no significant difference between the levels. So the conclusions, there was higher levels of arsenic in controls in the endemic area. So would that mean there's a higher exposure? And the urinary arsenic levels in CKDU cases, there were no difference. And so is this levels of arsenic in urine, is it high enough to aggravate oxidative damage is the question. And however, if you take the Bangladesh situation where there is arsenicosis in Bangladesh, you can see the drinking water, they had very high levels of arsenic. And spot urine, you can see the levels are much, much higher. And quite interestingly, these patients do not have chronic kidney disease. In fact, their creatinine levels were lower than the controls in the reported cases. So arsenic probably, I do not believe it can cause chronic kidney disease. And the drinking water, all the studies, the concluded drinking water were safe and they do not have any arsenic cadmium level. So in the region, drinking water is free of heavy metals. So this is, we have done some studies on biomarkers, and all the biomarkers were high in patients with chronic kidney disease. However, I think this will give us some future, this would be important for some future studies. Here all, these are the patients who have very advanced kidney disease, so they can have all the biomarkers could be high. Perhaps the patients who have early chronic kidney disease, very early disease, can have very selective biomarkers that would be a good research tool, I believe. So in India, similar disease, they also have excluded the presence of heavy metals in water. Quite interesting. So the one other thing common is the extreme hot weather conditions, and they are also looking at silica in wells, quite interestingly, whether it is silica can be, because they have very deep wells in this region, and that water has quite a bit of silica, so they are studying on these aspects. And the again, the Central American situation, they also, you can see, thinking about the same lines, whether it is agrochemicals, whether it is heavy metals, their research also going on the same direction. And another common thing is extreme weather conditions. Could that be the cause? Or whatever the toxicants that are present, can they cause more damage to the kidneys when the patient, people are dehydrated? So you can see this, the temperatures are quite high in the region. So they are so found with one study where they studied the renal tubular function of farmers of high prevalence areas in the CKDU, where they looked at the osmolarity, sodium, calcium, chloride in the urine before and after work. They found that there were some differences which were which got better after the intervention, where they give better quality natural spring water. So they did the same test, repeated the test after giving them the natural spring water, and where they corrected these abnormalities. So there is something in here. So whether it is include water intake that give change it, or is it really the dehydration effect yet to be sorted out. So in conclusion, so probably this is multifactorial. So maybe, is it chronic exposure? We need more data, because you can see the data, they are not all going in the same direction. So could it be arsenic and nephrotoxic pesticides? We need more studies. Or is it calcium and water balance? Or is it a genetic susceptibility, heat, stress, any, or could be any other factors which we have not thought of so far. So however, these are two patients. So it had become a major public health issue. As Raj mentioned, getting the treatment very expensive, has to travel very long distances. Even the kidney transplantation, getting live donors are impossible, because in the same family, same region, relatives, they are all affected or maybe having early disease. So there's huge socio-economic impact in the region to the individuals. The cost of healthcare, a lot of social impacts. There are a lot of perceptions and responses, because nobody knows what is causing. So they think, is it the water? Or is it, they think, they wonder whether they themselves to blame by using the excessive and careless use of fertilizers, safety. Sometimes they wonder whether to eat the fish and about the safety of the food items consumed. And in the communities, they have very limited coping mechanism. They are stigmatization. And some people even migrate out of the region, and they cultivate less land, so huge economic impact to the province as well as to the nation. So what interventions? Perhaps supply clean drinking water, pipe-borne water. Supply is impractical because they are very distributed over large areas, so it becomes... So what is happening now is reverse osmosis units, particularly in the schools, they go and install the reverse osmosis units. However, we do not know the health hazards of using the water from the reverse osmosis units that need to be explored. And that would particularly help to remove the calcium and fluoride. And the heavy metals, we are not worried because water does not contain any heavy metals. So, and if you can give more water for the people to drink, that would avoid harmful effects of dehydration and heat stress. And with regards to the agrochemicals, we have very tough regulations on agrochemicals, importing, licensing. However, perhaps we need to look at more on the export and particularly the use. Educate them, because you saw the photographs, they use the pesticides without using any protective gear. So that is something, correct doses, the safe use, all these instructions has to be given to the farmers. And smoking, I did not show, we got some, smoking came as a risk factor in one of the studies, and it's known that smoking has high cadmium in the cigarettes, as well as it can, smoking can damage the kidneys, so therefore, legislation, we have legislation against smoking, but need more health education. Early diagnosis, there are screening programs, however they become expensive, and the treatment facilities, AC inhibitors is the drug that we do use. It's been shown in one study it will reduce the proteinuria, however it does not change the progression of the disease. Limited facilities for the dialysis and the cost factors. We need more counselors to the region, health education, and need more social support. So in conclusion, so we currently witnessing a major catastrophic health problem. So probably of a sometimes maybe global dimensions when you look at the other hotspots in the world, and less privileged communities are affected. So we need more strengthening of research to find out the exact etiology. Even I think exclude in certain conditions, like it's not heavy metal, water is safe. Even that is important right at the moment. And we have to strengthen the medical care in the region.